Hi there, my name is Scott Phillips. I'm the president and founder of StarFish Medical. Microfluidics is a field we've been tracking for some years, and we really decided to double down on it recently because we think it's going to be very important in the future as this shift to point of care diagnostics really accelerates. So today in this video, you'll get to hear from some of our experts on some of the technology aspects, regulatory aspects, including human factors, and also the pieces about the reader and all the associated technology to make your project work. Hope you really get a lot of benefit from this, and thank you for watching.
Hello, my name is Nick Allen. I am the functional manager for the Bioservices Group here at StarFish Medical. Often, I get asked, what's the big deal about microfluidics, and why is it important to me? Well, as a microbiologist, I spent the better part of my career in the lab working with an instrument called a pipette. This instrument is a good friend of mine. It delivers very precise, accurate quantities of volume, typically in the order of 5 to 10 microliter ranges is what I work in. When I'm doing experiments in lab, I rely very heavily on this instrument to deliver those precise quantities into my assay. I rely that it is calibrated precisely, and so I spend a good deal of money, on the pipette in the beginning. These things can cost up to $1,000. I certify them every year, and that takes a lot of calibration and cost associated with that. But most importantly, it's the training and the skill set that goes into learning how to operate this instrument efficiently, understanding when you're taking a sample, how to use it accurately and depress it properly, and understanding what fluids are going into it, if there's bubbles, mixing it appropriately, and transferring it to the correct places. And so imagine now, instead of having someone manually moving those samples around and positioning them into an experiment, we're now going to rely on a fluidic card to do all of that work and handle the fluid transferring from one reagent well to another, running it to a reader to do the evaluation of it. Taking that entire skill set and putting that into a microfluidic chip, that's the specialty around microfluidics, and that's why microfluidics and having expertise in that area is so important to developing new point of care technologies.
My name is Lorenzo Gutierrez. I'm the microfluidic manager at the StarFish Medical. I have been working on microfluidic field for over 20 years now. As member of microfluidic team, my task is on the translation of assay into microfluidic format for clinical application and production. My role covers the integration of assay protocol, cartridge design and development of processing and detection equipment, including data analytics. We have a number of clients that we supported during the development of their microfluidic enabled products, one of which requested us to build a microfluidic cartridge that could detect a certain biomarker in blood. The first thing we did was to review the assay protocol and its target product profile. We checked all the previous experiments their team had done to enable us to identify the level of maturity of the assay that they developed, as well as the protocol. We had multiple discussions, and we conducted a validation experiment to increase our level of confidence. After the assay protocol was determined, we designed a concept cartridge based on the assay protocol. We reviewed the concept and identified all the potential technical and operational risks. We identified lots of details, including sequence timing and simplest way to execute the protocol. We did detailed design works for the cartridge and simulation for the fluid flows. At the end, we were able to quickly prototype a functional microfluidic cartridge in-house in support for the preclinical testing.
I'm yours, Vanderheider. I'm the Bioservices Program Manager at StarFish Medical. And today I want to speak a little bit about microfluidics. In my past, I worked on several medical devices that were used at the point of care. And when I hear microfluidics, I immediately get excited about the prospect of microfluidics and how it can take the technology that's traditionally performed in a laboratory environment and can take it all the way to an environment outside of that laboratory where a user can use it, like for example, a nurse or a doctor can use it to get an immediate result for the patient, or a patient can even use it themselves at the spot to get a result for themselves. So often microfluidics are used to make a device easier to use, and you can really hit different levels of easiness in your workflow. And it's important to consider that sometimes a different level, like a level of easiness, can come at a cost. And it can come at a cost of a technical complexity that's in your device, and it can come at a cost of goods around your consumables. So it's very important to find and hit the right balance between the complexity, the technical complexity and cost of goods, and the easiness of the workflow. So once you've designed a microfluidic device, a regulatory body will want to see specifically about usability, that you're kind of use and abuse your device. And they refer to that as flex studies. And those flex studies are there to show what will happen if a user kind of misuses the device or accidentally makes a mistake along the way, and that it doesn't drive you to faulty results, or that a user can see when they've made a mistake.
Hi, I'm Mike Lovelace. I'm an industrial designer with StarFish Medical. I work in the industrial design and human factors team, where we focus on the interactions between people and medical devices. In processing a fluid or a sample through microfluidics, there are many touch points where a user has to interact either with the sample, the cartridge, or their device. That could be anywhere from obtaining the cartridge to loading the sample into it, loading the cartridge into the device. There's a specific interaction there. And the list goes on and on, all the way down to how do you dispose of that cartridge. Each one of those steps is important in obtaining a good result in the end. So when we look at it, we want to break down that entire process and look at every single one of those touch points. When we do that, we're able to create a very impactful difference, a very impactful user experience into that process, and improve the outcomes in the end.
My name is Ryan Field. I'm an optical engineer here at StarFish. I have a background in ultrafast laser spectroscopy, which is a method of measuring changes in the optical properties of materials on very short timescales. And I've also done some work working in surgical laser systems and surgical microscopes. Lenses are an integral part of many optical devices, whether those devices are used to use light to affect a sample, to detect an amount of light, or to image a sample. In microfluidic devices, oftentimes external lens systems are used, but lenses can also be incorporated directly into the microfluidic cartridge. In the simplest case, those are static lenses, which are lenses that don't change over time. And those can be directly manufactured onto your cartridge. So in one example, those might be used to, the lenses might be cut directly into the microfluidic channels as curved surfaces that act as cylindrical lenses. Another example would be periodic arrays of very small lenses that can be used to enable the detection of light from many different sites at the same time. But in addition to stack lenses, it's also possible to incorporate dynamic lenses onto microfluidic cartridges. One example of that would be a fluid-filled lens, where the lens consists of a flexible plastic membrane with fluid behind it. And the curvature of the lens can be changed by changing the pressure of fluid inside the lens, thereby allowing the focal length to be changed. Another example of a fluid-filled lens in a microfluidic system is a lens where the fluid inside is mixed between two different components elsewhere on the chip, which allows its index of refraction to be changed. And then that liquid is pumped into the lens, which thereby changes its focal length. So there's a lot of options for incorporating lenses onto microfluidic cartridges. And in many cases, doing this can help reduce the cost or footprint of the device, and can also allow for automated control of some of the optics, as well as passive alignment of the optics.
What's your recommendation for companies developing their microfluidic cartridges? I have five recommendations. First, study the level of complexity of the assay. Second, determine the associated subsystem of the intended product. This means the detection and actuation of analytes and the integration of off-the-shelf parts. Third, identify the technical risk associated with the options during the cartridge development. Fourth, think about manufacturability of the cartridge and instrument. This will drive repeatability, yield, and cost. And lastly, consider the business aspects such as affordability and profitability.
If you'd like to know more about StarFish, we've been doing this for 20 years. We've developed hundreds of devices for companies all over the industry, and we've helped many founders become very successful and have big clinical impacts. That's what we really love for. So enjoy the content. If you'd like to talk to us about your project, we'd be happy to talk. Thank you.